Prologue. At rise is seen the entrance to a tent out of which steps an animal tamer, with long black curls, dressed in a white cravat, a vermilion dress coat, white trousers, and white top boots. He carries in his left hand a dog whip, and in his right a loaded revolver, and enters to the sound of cymbals and kettle drums.
Walk in! Walk in to the menagerie, proud gentlemen and ladies, lively and merry! With avid lust or cold disgust, the very beast without soul bound and made secondary to human genius to stay and see. Walk in, the show will begin. As customary, one child to each two persons comes in free. Here battle man and brute in narrow cages, where one in hot disdain his long whip lashes, and one with growls as when the thunder rages against the man's throat murderously dashes. Where now the crafty conquers, now the strong, now man, now beast lies cowed the floor along. The animal rears, the human on all fours, one ice-cold look of dominance, the beast submissive bows before that glance, and the proud heel upon his neck adores. Bad are the times, ladies and gentlemen, who once before my cage in thronging crescents crowded, now honour operas, and then Ibsen with their so highly valued presence. My boarders here are so in want of fodder that they reciprocally devour each other. How well off at the theatre is a player, sure of the meat upon his ribs, albeit his frightful hunger may tear him and he it, and colleagues' inner cupboards be quite bare. Greatness in art we struggle to inherit, although the salary never match the merit. What see you, whether in light or sombre plays? House-animals, whose mortals all must praise, who wreck pale spites in vegetarian ways, and revel in an easy cry or fret, just like those others down in the parquet. This hero has a head by one dram swirled, that is in doubt whether his love be right. A third you hear despairing of the world, full five acts long you hear him wail his plight, and no man ends him with a merciful slight. But the real beast, the beautiful wild beast, your eyes on that, I, ladies, only feast. You see the tiger that habitually devours whatever falls before his bound, the bear so ravenous originally, who at a late-night meal sinks dead to ground. You see the monkey, little and amusing, from sheer ennui his petty powers abusing. He has some talent of all greatness scant, so impudently coquets with his own want. Upon my soul, within my tent's a mammal. See, right behind the curtain here, a camel. And all my creatures fawn about my feet when my revolver cracks.
He shoots into the audience.
Behold, brutes tremble all around me. I am cold. The man stays cold, you with respect to greet. Walk in! You hardly trust yourselves in here. Then very well, judge for yourselves. Each sphere has sent its crawling creatures to your telling, chameleons and serpents, crocodiles, dragons, and salamanders chasm-dwelling. I know, of course, you're full of quiet smiles, and don't believe a syllable I say.
He lifts the entrance flap and calls into the tent.
Hi, Charlie! Bring our serpent just this way.
A stagehand with a big paunch carries out the actress of Lulu in her Pierrot costume and sets her down before the animal tamer.
She was created to incite to sin, to lure, seduce, poison, yea, murder in a manner no man knows. My pretty beast.
Tickling Lulu's chin.
Only be unaffected and not pieced out with distorted artificial folly, even if the critics praise thee for it less wholly. Thou hast no right to spoil the shape most fitting, most true of woman with meows and spitting. And mind, all foolery and making faces the childish simpleness of vice disgraces. Thou shouldst, to-day I speak emphatically, speak naturally and not unnaturally, for the first principle in every art since earliest times was true and plain, not smart.
To the public.
There's nothing special now to see in her, but wait and watch what later will occur. Her strength about the tiger she coils stricter, He roars and groans. Who'll be the final victor? Hop, Charlie, march. Carry her to her place.
The stagehand carries Lulu in his arms. The animal tamer pats her on the hips.
Sweet innocence, my dearest treasure case.
The stagehand carries Lulu back into the tent.
And now I'll tell the best thing in the day, my pole between the teeth of a beast of prey. Walk in, though to be sure the show's not new, yet everyone takes pleasure in its view. Wrench open this wild animal's jaws, I dare, and he to bite dares not. My pate's so fair, so wild, so gaily decked, it wins respect. I offer it him with confidence unchecked. One joke, and my two temples crack. But lo, the lightning of my eyes I will forego, staking my life against a joke, and throw my whip, my weapons, down. I am in my skin. I yield me to this beast. His name do ye know? The honoured public that has just walked in.
The animal tamer steps back into the tent, accompanied by cymbals and kettle-drums. Act One. A roomy studio. Entrance door at the rear, left. Another door at lower left to the bedroom. At center, a platform for the model, with a Spanish screen behind it and a Smyrna rug in front. Two easels at lower right. On the upper one is the picture of a young girl's head and shoulders. Against the other leans a reversed canvas. Below these, toward center, an ottoman with a tiger skin on it. Two chairs along the left wall. In the background, right, a stepladder. Shun sits on the foot of the ottoman, inspecting critically the picture on the further easel. Schwartz stands behind the ottoman, his palette and brushes in his hands.
Do you know, I'm getting acquainted with a brand new side of the lady.
I have never painted anyone whose expression changed so continuously. I could hardly keep a single feature the same, 2 days running.
Shun, pointing to the picture and observing him.
Do you find that in it?
I have done everything imaginable to call forth some sort of quiet in her mood by my conversation during the sittings.
Then I understand the difference.
Schwartz dips his brush in the oil and draws it over the features of the face.
Do you think that it makes it look more like her?
We can only work with art as scientifically as possible.
Tell me.
Schwartz, stepping back.
The colour had sunk in pretty well, too.
Shun, looking at him.
Have you ever loved a woman in your life?
Schwartz goes to the easel, puts a colour on it, and steps back on the other side.
The dress isn't made to stand out enough yet. We don't see the living body under it.
I make no doubt that the workmanship is good.
If you'll step this way.
Shun, rising.
You must have told her regular ghost stories.
As far back as you can.
Shun, stepping back, knocks down the canvas that was leaning against the lower easel.
Excuse me.
Schwartz, picking it up.
That's all right.
What is that?
Do you know her?
No.
Schwartz sets the picture on the easel. It is of a lady dressed as Pierrot with a long shepherd's crook in her hand.
A costume picture.
But really, you've succeeded with her.
You know her?
No. And in that costume?
It isn't nearly finished yet.
Shun nods.
What would you have? While she is posing for me, I have the pleasure of entertaining her husband.
What?
We talk about art, of course, to complete my good fortune.
But how did you make such a charming acquaintance?
As they're generally made. Ancient, tottering little man drops in on me here to know if I can paint his wife. Why, of course, were she as wrinkled as Mother Earth? Next day at 10, prompt, the doors fly open, and the fat belly drives this little beauty in before him. I can feel even now how my knees shook. Then comes a sap-green lackey, stiff as a ramrod, with a package under his arm. Where is the dressing-room? Imagine my plight. I opened the door there.
Pointing left.
Just luck that everything was in order. The sweet thing vanishes into it, and the old fellow posts himself outside as a bastion. 2 minutes later, out she steps in this Pierrot.
Shaking his head.
I never saw anything like it.
He goes left and stares in at the bedroom. Shun, who has followed him with his eyes.
And the fat belly stands guard?
Schwartz, turning round.
The whole body, in harmony with that impossible costume, as if it had come into the world in it. Her way of burying her elbows in her pockets, of lifting her little feet from the rug. The blood often shoots to my head.
One can see that in the picture.
Schwartz, shaking his head.
People like us, you know.
Here the model is mistress of the conversation.
She has never yet opened her mouth.
Is it possible?
Allow me to show the costume to you.
Goes out left. Shun, before the Pierrot.
A devilish beauty.
Before the other picture.
There's more depth here.
Coming down stage.
He is still rather young for his age.
Schwartz comes back with a white satin costume.
What sort of material is that?
Shun, feeling it.
Satin.
And all in one piece.
How does one get into it, then?
That I can't tell you.
Shun, taking the costume by the legs.
What enormous trouser legs.
The left one she pulls up.
Shun, looking at the picture.
Above the knee.
She does that entrancingly.
And transparent stockings?
Those have got to be painted specially.
Oh, you can do that.
And with it all, a coquetry.
What brought you to that horrible suspicion?
There are things that our school philosophy lets itself never dream of.
He takes the costume back into his bedroom. Shun, alone.
When we sleep.
Schwartz comes back, looks at his watch.
If you wish to make her acquaintance too.
No.
They must be here in a moment.
How much longer will the lady have to sit?
I shall probably have to bear the pains of Tantalus 3 months longer.
I mean the other one.
I beg your pardon. 3 times more, at most.
Going to the door with him.
If the lady will just leave me the upper part of the dress, then...
With pleasure. Let us see you at my house again soon. For heaven's sake.
As he collides in the doorway with Dr. Goll and Lulu.
May I introduce...
Dr. Goll to Shun.
What are you doing here?
Lulu, as Shun kisses her hand in greeting.
You're not going already?
But what wind blows you here?
I've been looking at the picture of my bride.
Lulu, coming forward.
Your bride is here.
So you're having work done here too?
Lulu, before the upper picture.
Look at it! Enchanting! Entrancing!
Dr. Goll, looking round him.
Have you got her hidden somewhere around here?
So that is the sweet young prodigy who's made a new person out of you.
She sits in the afternoon, mostly.
And you don't tell anyone about it?
Lulu, turning round.
Is she really so solemn?
Probably the after effects of the seminary still.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.